So, yeah, that was the leap motion. So this, I'm just gonna turn this guy off. So this guy, this little guy over here, it's a sort of a device still in at development stage. Has anybody heard about leap motion?
I've heard of it.
Okay, cool. That's this little thing, and what can I say about it? Well, so I've been for a while. I've been how to start it. Okay, I guess does anybody know about the reactable?
Heard about?
The reactable was a very like a big table they made about 10 years ago that had blocks, and you could like bring it closer and sort of do like FN synthesis and all sorts of really fun things in a very graphical manner, and it was very interactive. And when I saw that, I was like, wow, that's amazing. I wish I could someday have one of those. They're like $2,000 each.
I think
so.
It was an app.
Well, and then, yes, and then there was the app, as Sean.
I've seen the original, though, with the blocks, and you put them around on the table. And
I'm jealous.
It was pretty cool.
That's awesome. So yeah, once I got the app, I started playing around with it, and it was really a lot of fun. I'm going to just like, show it to you, so you guys can see what I'm talking about. And what I thought was, what I didn't know about it, I'd seen like people working with accelerometers before, with their sort of like, I don't know, handheld devices, but I never thought it was like that cool. To be honest, I was just like, I didn't see any interesting things about it. But as you can see, like it's this, like it's a little table, and you start dropping like little cubes in it, and there are oscillators, and there's like modulators, and all sorts of fun little things. And what I found that was really cool is that you can use an accelerometer in it. And then for the first time I thought, well, like just actually moving an object and performing with it using motion was something that was interesting. And so I went down that lane and I started like figuring out other ways to use accelerometers that I thought was interesting. And and at the moment, at the same time, I was sort of interested in that. I was really interested in the sound of metals, of metal instruments, metal objects and stuff, gongs. I was going through a whole like spectralist phase, I guess. I don't know if anybody heard of the term spectralist. It means that you sort of look at the at sound at a microscopic level, like the sine tones and like the spectra, and you sort of work with that and you develop a narrative based on that. And so I thought, well, it would be really cool if I could sort of put these two things together. Sort of like, and I got more into Max, which I've always been more of an acoustic composer, so I actually started getting into music technology, which was a weird thing for me because I was super about acoustics. Anyway, what am I saying? Yeah, I started working with sort of OSC and sort of being able to track and transmit the using the accelerometers of handheld devices and sort of communicate with Max. And I have a video loaded up, but it's not there anymore. Oh wait, I have it. So yeah, this led into creating an actual piece where I was using sort of fast Fourier transform processes over metal sounds. Fast Fourier transforms are just, I mean, for those who don't know, basically you can work with the time domain and like the rhythm, and you can pick up a block of sound and you can separate the rhythm of it from its pitch content and sort of work with other sounds and sort of mix them around. And so, what I was interested in doing is be able to manipulate the nature of the sound with the movement. Sort of be able to create timbre, the same way you would be performing a certain instrument, sort of with certain movements, be able to really create some sort of intimate relationship between a certain sound and the physical movement And so this is where I sort of created my first, my first electronic piece ever, which was this. Thank you. except that would be a total lie. I think it was the first time I actually performed an electronic piece. I had done little exercises, worked with Mac. I've done little exercises with sort of signal processing here and there, but never actually had an opportunity of performing or presenting myself with an electronic piece. I mean, through a composition, I learned how to do it. Yeah, and I mean, I guess also as somebody who's interested in spectralism, I've always been very interested in sort of the analysis of sound, so that involves music technology. So there was no way, yeah, I mean, it'd be sort of a fallacy if I said it, and no contact with electronics. Anyway, if I'm making no sense, you can let me know. What's the next step? So as you can see in this piece, basically what I did is like I picked a sound of a gong that I really liked, and from there on I recorded it, and through the data that I was obtaining from the movement of these two objects. Does everybody know what an accelerometer is? I was sort of filtering and sort of extracting certain information from. I can just show you the patch. From those sounds, and from there on, being able to create a piece that had to do with that responded to my physical movements in a very intuitive way. Yet it was, and at the same time. Make it very expressive, yet it was sort of very ethereal and very sort of disembodied and electronic at the same time, and I really like that. Like I've always, creating a piece that sort of had to do with expressing myself physically. But yet at the same time, the result of it to be very sort of ethereal and very, to have that sort of, that aesthetic from metal sounds, which I really, really like. And so this piece had like several stages, sort of understanding how it works. This is a mess, as you can see. First of all, like, as you can see, let's see right here, this has to do with, being able to track all come up with a way to track the XY motion of the accelerometer in a way that would allow me to move the sound, because initially it was intended to be like an 8-channel piece, so there was like 8 speakers, and so this would allow me to move the piece and do diffusion of the sound itself with the movement accelerometer. And I thought that was really cool because I like the idea of sort of controlling the spatiality of sound through movement, and I thought that was cool. There's a whole idea of like, you know, just controlling like the radius of a circle and the idea of 8-channel speakers. There's all these gong samples from which I sort of just deleted the most important part of it, which I was going to do in the demonstration, how I sort of extract the spectra from the sounds themselves to kind of create new sounds. And so, for example, in the piece, and like during the video I was showing you about me performing, there's a hit, and then there's a sustained high pitch, which pretty much is just like a partial that was extracted from the gong sound and then sustained, and from there on sort of spatialized throughout the space. So I guess, I mean, what I'm talking here is what they call gesture recognition technology. For those of you who don't know what that is, basically it's just a realm from computer science, which right now is sort of studying how to capture human movement, both it could be facial or physical, and it has a huge sort of impact in the whole realm of human computer interaction, and sort of in making the interaction sort of much more of input with the machine, which before was not capable. And so, I mean, we've heard of devices like the Kinect, where the Kinect is basically also like a it's a depth sensor camera. Yes, that allows to sort of give the machine input through physical motion, and the whole process of tracking the limbs of the person or the performer who's using the Kinect, all that math that has to do with gesture recognition. I am just getting into what this whole means. I'm going to be very honest. And that what I've realized is that the whole process of mapping, which is, I guess, what I was presenting right here, the idea of how the movement and the data sent from the motion and how what is detected, how it interprets into sound. And that's actually what I'm mostly interested in as a sound artist. I'm studying math and understanding a little bit of how all the algorithms work, but it's a very, 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 very complex. And but what really interests me is, because nowadays there's, as you can see, there's new gadgets that allows us to sort of give the machines new forms of input that are incredible. There's biometrics that allows us to take sort of scientific, the sort of biological data and transform it into sound. Well, there's accelerometers, there's microcontrollers, and what does that mean in terms of the aesthetics? Like, how do we, when we choose to use an interactive a device that we're interacting with and we're performing with, how do we correlate the movement, which in itself is a statement? The performer moving, I think, is a very powerful statement on stage, and how that translates into the sound itself. That being said, that's where the mapping process comes in understanding what are the nuances from movement that sort of, that we want to capture that are expressive and that we want the machine to somehow interpret, and how do we want to interpret? I mean, this could, the movements of both these objects could be just sort of translated into a video piece. It could be anything. The same thing with the leap. And so that's something I'm interested in. And what else am I going to say?
How do you decide what sounds to use then?
Yeah. Okay. That's a great question, because that I did want to talk about that. So I guess I'm a frustrated breakdancer and a frustrated believe it or not, I'm also a frustrated conductor. I started conducting for a while, and I guess I'm also a frustrated martial artist. So what I'm trying to say is that for me, movement has always been a thing, and I've worked with dancers for a long time, and in my mind, there's always been sort of a representation of the sound, like of the sort of the kinetic energy of the sound of somebody who moves, and that's something that's definitely informed the aesthetic process, or like the decision process I was talking before in terms of the mapping. How does the sound really interpret how does the movement is interpreted into the sound? How does it really represent it, and not just be like, oh, I'm moving my hands and this really crazy sound is coming up, but how am I really, is there an intimacy between the movements that I'm doing and the sound that's coming out of it? I was just recently in Greece for the International Conference on Computer Music. I was lucky to be there, and there was tons of pieces like this, and some of them I thought were amazing, and some of them I felt they were not so effective. And one of the thoughts, the reason why I'm saying that is because I didn't see really a relationship between the sound. I felt that there was a disjointment between the sound and the movement itself. I can't say that maybe that was part of the pieces that we're trying to present, but I think that is something to be considered. The physicality of the performer on stage is something that is affecting the performance. And so, yeah.
Are you taking questions?
I will soon, I just want to exhaust myself and then I'll just go.
Okay, sorry.
Unless you have something that really it's gonna.
Oh no, it just was something relating to what you said in this question. I was thinking, do you have in mind that you want to try to create something emotional then? Would you say that you're trying to express a kind of a feeling?
No.
Excitement or?
No, not it's by expressing, I mean, it's sort of a more, in a form of expression at a much more reptilian level. We're not talking at sort of an emotional level, but at the point where the physical gestures, the minimal nuances of somebody's movement are expressed. And I find that to be very unique. It became very, very unique to me, to you, because everybody has a very specific way they move. And so I guess part of the sort of the artistic statement in that is that, like, I'm trying to capture what makes me unique in terms of movement. Does that answer? And at the same time, what's interesting about that is that pushes me to create an instrument, because at the same time, what I'm doing here, or what I just showed you with the leap, I'm creating an instrument that fits my movement. Like, if I brought any of you guys to actually do it, maybe your flexibility would be more or less, and so that would not be comfortable for you. You would not feel the instrument the same way I do it. And I think that's a very important process in terms of creating an instrument that is genuinely personal, which is important in improvisation, which is something I'm also very interested in. What else? Oh, okay, so yeah, that was accelerometers, and so here's the leap. Leap is it's sort of a new device that everybody's super excited about, but still has a lot of limitations. Basically, it's also a depth sensing camera. It's very small. You guys can come over if you want to watch, or we can see it later. What separates it from the Kinect, I guess, is that it tracks hands to millimetric, to very, very subtle, to a very small detail. So, I mean, here's the visualizer that the Leap ring comes with. And what the Kinect, I mean, the way the Kinect works also is a bit with a skeleton sort of model, which sort of tracks certain points of your body and works from there. There's ways of creating more detailed skeletons from that. But what's really interesting about the Leap is that it picks joints at a very, very detailed manner, which allows for movement to be sent into the computer in a very, very detailed and subtle way. You can see. Sort of. So it detects about, I would say, feet. And then it just kind of falls apart.
Can you bend your fingers this way?
Yeah. Now, that's an issue. If I turn, it can recognize if I turn my hands upside down, but once I'm hiding my fingers and my fingers are out of the...
Right, because I can't see that.
Because it can't see from above, right?
Yeah.
So that's obviously some of the limitations of it. As well as that, the camera, sorry, the little cord that Leap has made is really bad, because half of it, I assume, is the information coming in, and the other half has to do with, has a very weird kind of connection, has to do with actually feeding electricity into the device, and it cuts out constantly, and that's just very annoying. Sometimes it just, like, you'll have your hands, oh, see, there you go, like, it's just trying to figure out what's going on with my hand, and then it changed colors, and once it does that, it means it sort of rebooted the whole system, so when you're performing, it will help cut out that data in, and it will crash or do something really annoying. So, yeah, it's still an object and a device development stage. It's been used with the Oculus Rift as a form of sort of adding, be able to see your hands within the virtual reality that the Oculus provides. There is another one coming up made by the guys that made Kinect called the Nimble, which is coming up next year, about 2015. And from the looks of it, it's they've compared the algorithms and the way it sort of tracks, especially what you just said, because it sort of has a further depth that I think is going to be better, but well, that's remains to be seen, so.
And how much is that in comparison
the Nimble, I think it's at a Kickstarter level, so it's being, and I think it's about $100, and this guy's about 80.
Okay.
It's relatively, I guess the Leap can be used as a mouse. It has some really cool other applications to it. I mean, I guess there's they've made a really good effort in terms of creating like a whole library of tools and developer tools, and in that sense the community is really great. There's some really trippy apps to it which I think are cool. So I mean, even for gaming and all that stuff that people are looking to use it for. There's obviously some very cool applications in the concepts themselves. Sculpting is one of the ones I think is one of the most interesting, that allows for sort of three-dimensional sculpting using your hands in a virtual reality environment. I guess with Oculus this would be really cool. So I forgot how this is used, whatever, I really don't use it. But I mean, I guess like what happens is you can choose your materials and then sort of turn it around and be able to see it in a three-dimensional space, and at the same time be able to like alter it and blah blah blah. This is
you haven't finished.
how was it that, okay, this
yep.
one's to actually rotate. Okay, so yeah, this one's to rotate the, and this guy, oh see, and with the other one I'm painting it. Okay, see, I'm the total noob on this. I'm just gonna for those of you who thought I was tech savvy, no sir. Okay, I guess we're just gonna give up.
Gesture. Command Q.
That's what I'm
doing. Oh, that's what you're doing.
Yeah, just. There we go. Thank you. Yeah, and I guess I'll just like quickly mention it comes. The software that I used to communicate with Max for the first thing that I kind of played around with. Is this little software called Gecko, which is actually one I wanna say like I downloaded, man, I paid at least $40 in different sort of interfaces that sort of talked through OSC with to Max, and I wanna say this one's actually the most reliable one. And it doesn't really work as a gesture tracking, because it works based on general movements of the hands, but it doesn't allow for proper finger movement, which is kind of what this thing is supposed to be. But I guess it's still a developer stage story. But yeah, in the sense that it allows to sort of choose and sort of customize certain movements and decide which ones, I guess it allows for close and open hand sort of. Guess any questions?
Do your arms get tired? Because when I tried Leap, I was like, oh yeah, this is the future, we're gonna do like this. I was like, I'm exhausted. I'm like,
yeah, I think because there's so much of a need for haptic response from like the virtual reality, like even with that, you really try to grasp things and that creates tension. I mean, I see myself like after when I
just
like,
doing that, like maybe because you're a musician, you do that a lot, but that's a tiring motion compared to just having your fingers on a keyboard.
The technical term is gorilla arms.
Okay.
Well, yeah, no, I want to say that that's where it becomes really interesting, the whole physicality of it in terms of getting used to also just moving. I want to say like we're just simply not used to moving our arms at all. So it comes down to maybe the problem is that we lack, for somebody maybe does Tai Chi, you'd be like awesome at it. I don't know.
Oh, no, I was just trying. I was just holding my arm up.
I mean, I from some of the movements that I find it really interesting. Basically, what I'm doing here is I'm just doing a little bit of convolution between affect synthesis and noise, which is something I like doing. And the idea of knobs, I really like the idea of sort of having sort of like virtual knobs in a way, but it's not working now. No, it doesn't. Which I thought was kind of cool, but other than that, I kind of, the whole idea of just moving the hands up and down just makes me think of theremin. You know, and so if it came down to actually controlling pitch and controlling some sort of modulation with the other hand, I don't think this would be the ideal thing to use. Still interesting concept, and it has a lot of potential, which I really look forward to sort of develop, because I really feel frustrated, I guess, as if somebody wants to sort of interact with the machine in a more gestural way, but still it's a good step.
Sorry, Kim, did you play some music with it too?
Yeah, I'll just do it again, and I'll talk while I'm doing it so the kids know that it's not black magic.
It's good to present it first in a theatrical way.
Yeah, it makes me look like I actually came up with something for this presentation. I actually had another performance that I was planning on doing, but like I deleted the main gong sound from which I extract all the other pitches, and so I'm like just kind of thrown off by that. Here we go. So yeah, as you can say, it's sort of.
Is there an interface between Max and this?
This guy right
device
here.
That's automatic.
This guy right here. Okay.
Oh, I see.
This guy. Oh. Yeah, let me just make some noise. So basically at this point it just recognized that the hand is there, and I have assigned the yawn aspect of it, which allows me to control one of the knobs. And then I use the Z axis to sort of control something else with both hands. Then with my right hand, sort of the same. Yeah. And then I'm controlling I think it's the carrier wave of the convolution while I'm doing that. Yeah.
To me, that sounds way more interesting than a theremin.
Yeah, no, I mean definitely, but I think like I guess what I'm looking for is the fingers. That would be something really interesting, to work with. I mean, there's one of the sort of, I think it's Better Touch, OC Motion, I want to say. The basically what it does, it follows solely the fingers.
Hmm.
So that in an X, Y, and Z sort of dimension, and I guess like you could assign many, many variables to all these and make, but then again, you're losing the other joints of your hands, so this is just like your fingers, so again, it's...
So no one has an OSC one that just outputs all the joints?
I think not. I don't think, I think you probably, there is, I mean, there's the basic, I think if you're tech savvy, which I'm not. You could probably pick, if the visualizers are just picking up all the joints, you'd probably be able to like send in everything.
Yeah.
Now, it's really like, I was trying to do, I guess, convolution, which is kind of a little bit hard on the system, and this at the same time, and it was always on the verge of just exploding. So, literally exploding. Any comments, any thoughts?
Are you going to do an 8-channel piece with this at some point?
Yeah, I mean, I have many ideas of what to do with this. I think mostly what I'm kind of interested, I guess I'll just show you another question I'm working on. It's the idea of sort of building sound within my hands, which I thought would be kind of really cool. This kind of relates at the same time with my whole spectralist fetish that I have. I could just call it a fetish, totally.
College here in Edmonton, and he is now exploring possible applications of games to teach music, and this is part of the master's program in humanities computing. Today Simeon will be presenting on using open source software to create Minecraft-like games for sound creation.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I tried to kind of gauge the room and who was here beforehand, and I kind of gathered that everyone has at least touched some form of graphical programming environment. I don't know, maybe show of hands. So like, yeah, there are one, two people who haven't. So that was a difficult decision I had to make in terms of how I was gonna do presentation, because I didn't know. And I decided I would gear it to the low side in case people were here, because I kind of like the idea of promoting artists who are maybe like on the verge of exploring this stuff to feel comfortable going a step further. And so I kind of hedged my bets by getting a little bit more artsy in my presentation as well for the more computer science oriented people. So I don't know. Well, you can't really see the captions. Okay, so. And Andrew didn't come here, which is too bad, or he would have read, he would have brought his animatronic puppets in, and we would have done a performance of this on the screen, which unfortunately. Oh, yeah. Who are we? Why are we here? Asks the cube up in the corner. One replies, we're musical dice for playing musical games. But broadcast media eliminated the need for such games years ago. Drat! Let's go digital and teach music literacy so we can once again rule the masses. Yes, but where will you find computer programmers to do our evil bidding? Shh! I just spotted an entire room full of humans. Let's send in special agents and so my idea with this presentation was I was going to recruit you into, I guess, the frivolous and fictional side of doing programming, and sort of some of the ways I had to create metaphors for myself in order to get into programming. And we're going to learn about these cubes. Oh yes, this is weird. I wish this could be brought down because there's a bunch of titles there.
Nope.
Is there a way to go with the remote?
You can not go in full screen mode, and you can move the window down a little bit. We'll lose full screen, but if you're really concerned about it.
No. That's.
So get rid of your tasks view and maybe your slides view.
Tasks. Slides view. Thank you very much, sir.
Oh, you gotta click outside the thing. It's awkward.
Slide.
Just use left and right, or page up, page down, I think.
Okay.
Oh.
Okay. We're just gonna put that. What is that?
Slide sorter.
Okay.
I think you click normal actually, sorry.
No. If I just close it in the program, it's gonna. There we go.
I'm doing something.
Oh, that's working. Oh, wow.
There we go.
It's working.
Yeah. Do you want to build musical dice? Because you're nearly program processes. Right. That's the audience perfect. Because dice want you to program so they can teach music. I'm convinced. learned how to program in minutes with this one weird trick. First, we'll look at musical dice. This might be actually more interesting because these objects have a history. In my music teaching, which I had to do to make money as a music student, I learned that even 2 to 3 year old children get the concept of lining up musical dice and doing stuff with them. You add a few rules to this and you've got a learning activity for music composition. The physical dice, as it turns out, are far more flexible than this static page of Stockhausen's piano piece, 11, yeah. How this would work if I set this pile of objects down in front of a 2-year-old who's played the game once before, is they'll pick different ones, line them up like this, and then say, okay, 1, 2, ready, go, tick-a-tee-tee, tick-a-ta, tee-tee-tee-tee, tick-a-ticka. Which is exactly what an orchestral percussionist would do, except he wouldn't say those neat little syllables that go with each unit of rhythmic sound. He would just play. And that would be a part. So other things about these dice, if I put them in a bag and dump them out on the floor, and then the kid starts playing with them, and then I try to put some back because I only want them to make a row of 6. They'll say, you can't do that, which is weird. I can't hide them once they're there, so I learn to put less in the bag when I dump them out. Something about the objects themselves imply what you're supposed to do with them. If there are 10 cubes, you're supposed to do something with 10 cubes. If there are 20 cubes, if there were 120, we'd probably end up building a fort with it. So it's an interesting way. I kind of had to take an interface first approach to designing games because I didn't have software to go with what I wanted to do. So I'll get into software a little bit. Piano piece 11 turns out to be Stockhausen's first aleatoric piece, just means dice in Greek, I believe. He placed a bunch of elements on a page and said, hey, performer, go to whichever one you feel like going to next. This is one of the ones that we had to study in music history class. But turns out, even though this is a 20th century experimental music, even Haydn and Mozart use musical dice for different things. I take it, since this is an image off the Yale websites, that this is these dice that appeared first on the screen were some dating from the 18th century. If they managed to create a version of them, find a version of them, that the paper wouldn't rot away. So today's problems, obviously, I can do this with my students, but there are very few that I get to teach. And these are all children of parents who are well enough to pay me exorbitant amounts per hour to teach the kids. So digital seemed like a way to go for how could you broaden access that people had to things like this. And this is more of my pyramid scheme. So. So we're talking about programmers. It's happened a lot in the computer games industry. I don't know if we need to read through these entire quotes. It's just that they've had these collaborations that have hired programmers to come on and said, let's do a new open source platform for what we want to build, or let's get the latest Unreal Engine and for what we want to build. And it goes along with you know, just doing things properly at the outset, so you have a base for what you want to do. What's happened to some teachers that are interested in using games is they said, hey, let's forego this kind of software development process. Let's let's make paper games for the classroom and use them because they're a lot more immediate, and we as teachers have control over how the dynamics of these things are going to work. And this is an interesting third approach that some people have taken. This is an article I read. I won't read the entire article back, but someone created a game with game salad, which is like parts of games that you can select, like Word, Microsoft Word templates, and just threw them together and managed to place it in the top 10 list of iPhone apps and made tens of thousands of dollars over a short period of time just because of the placement. And so when I started my master's, I wanted to work on this idea of placement. So I got an arcade machine. I figured if I can put my game in an arcade machine and put it somewhere, then I can have people try out the prototype a little sooner than I could if I was just inviting people to an event where I could show off my demo software. I could leave it somewhere and people would try it out. So, all right. And more. And so over the course of last summer, I started thinking about, well, can I build this part in PE? Can I build this part in PE, pure data, an open source version of Max MSP? And I got a little further each time, and so I eventually got through a process of cloning something that's a little bit like Minecraft. And along the way, I read articles like this. This is Far Cry, How the Fire Burns and Spreads. It's an article about how the programmer who worked on Far Cry 2 was scared of trying to model realistic fire dynamics for this action game where you're running around a terrain and you're just shooting, blowing things up, and fire is spreading everywhere, and fire is basically a toy in the game that you can experiment setting different things on fire. And he just modeled this using a grid where the source of the fire would points, and based on the hit points that it had, would be able to spread its fire to another square, and that square would have less hit points, but nonetheless would be able to spread to the squares around it. And even though this is a complex 3D game, the fire system itself was based on a 2D grid that looked at the world and divided up into different places where the fire could spread. Important in a real-time environment that's for interaction, that you focus on the interaction, making it work efficiently. If you sacrifice a little bit of realism, that's probably fine, as long as the game is still fun and doesn't completely get away from realism. Okay, so I guess I covered some of this a little bit. One thing about pure data that I found really nice, after working for a semester in PHP, and which is really not super dynamic, and a little bit in JavaScript, which is more dynamic, is the code in PE is always running, which is great. I can tell if I screwed up or not right away. Save me a little bit of time. So pure data using a linear flow model, not super great for, makes an inefficient interface to OpenGL, which uses a state model where you have objects, you're sending them their transform information. According to the author of pure data who worked on the gem portion, this was 100,000 plus lines of code, and in the end it's still confusing, and I don't think a lot of people have really used it a lot as of that. And so then, being the stubborn blockheaded person that I am, I decided, well, let's see what we can actually do with the software, because it does think in a way that's similar to the way I think, and it does do sound well. That was kind of my initial grounds for my initial mistake. And so if you haven't used Gem at all, the code kind of looks like this. gem head object at the top indicates that you're sending a message somewhere to have something be rendered on the screen. It goes through some processing in the middle, in this case, some modifications made to the X and Y coordinates of something, and then down to the cube below. And this code literally produces this on the screen. What I really wanted to have was something like this. And there is somewhere in the advanced help files an example similar to this, but it wasn't clearly documented and it wasn't clear like what you could actually do to this. What you're actually doing here, this is the same code as in the first slide. And this bit of code basically uses a message box which could have multiple items separated by commas to change one attribute of the cube at a time. Actually fire up PE and show you essentially what this does. So, here we have an example of code where we're using a metronome object. Metronome just sends a pulse through this input, changes the counter, and changes what this gem head object gathers as it's going along to create a frame that's going to be rendered. So every 1 second, the cube's being moved to a new location. If I change that to every 1 millisecond, then you get the illusion that there are two cubes there. Okay. So then we get the illusion that there are three cubes there. Maybe four, or that there's a cube that's moving between them. So this is, if it was actually updating at 1 millisecond, this metro object is in fact lying to us. That's not updating on the screen that fast. It's actually going like 20 frames per second, which is way slower. Then instead of having one cube, we'd have four cubes, and if we could do that 400 times every frame, then we would have a world like Minecraft, with this one column being just one area of the screen. So this ends up being a lot more efficient than going to this code, which I tried to do at first, and just copying and pasting it however many times you need more cubes. PE has a way of creating objects, like throwing them into your code dynamically if you want, but it usually takes about a second to throw in a new bit of code. So when I wanted to load up a level with 100,000 cubes in it, it took 100,000 seconds. And after trying it the first time, I realized 100,000 seconds is a long time for loading it. So, So that's where this metaphor came in handy. So it's near. This was kind of the approach I took in thinking to how could I move the character from place to place. I thought of it as a thumbtack on a board,
on the grid,
where I would calculate the distance of the string connecting to the two thumbtacks and its angle. And then this is where the one weird equation comes in. If you know the length of your radius of the circle, which was your string, and you know the angle, you can calculate the XY. That turned out to not be super hard. I went to mathisfun.com and copied this very carefully into my code to create an object that would tell me the relative distances between things. So, so taking that idea of sending one message in at a time, I just turned x and y coordinates into a linear format. So this is similar to what you would have in an apartment building. You have apartment, so that would be in the basement floor. And then down here you've got floor 1307. This ended up being a convenient way to work in a signal flow based environment, converting back into x and y. So I'm sending all of these numbers into GEM, and what you see with the code is that it's drawing the basement floor of the apartments, the next floor, the next floor, the next floor, the next floor, there, and it's all in this one message. That's of being sent about an actual 120 times per second. So you have the same thing where you would have scrolling cubes, basically. Okay. And I guess I'm getting close to the end of time. And there's other stuff I wanted to get through, but. So I had to create some way to convert back from this format of apartment floors into X and Y again. And that was just discarding the remainder. So I would divide it by 100 and see how many floors I got, however, and so forth. And so then when this message comes, all those 400 numbers are being translated into x and y coordinates before each frame is rendered. So it goes 400 times before each frame is rendered. And that appears to be about the limit. Minecraft actually gives you the illusion of having tens of thousands of cubes on the screen at once. So I wouldn't recommend actually doing Minecraft in PD because the frame rate would get pretty low.
Can you show what it does?
Yeah, I'm just, okay.
I've never played Minecraft anymore.
What I'm doing now is reconnecting an object. I thought would have time to build 101 or 1304 from a table. It's looking up that in a table and saying what value should we use for okay, Excel spreadsheet. So if this is, so 37 would be 307, apartment 307. Basically, the table would just store 307, and then another number that would say if it's 1, let's make that apartment vacant. If it's 0, let's make that apartment not vacant. Where this goes back to the code that I'm drawing is it looks that up, and it tells me I'm going to get values between 1 and 4, and I'm sending them directly to the translate Z. So that's going to move cubes up and down, depending on whether there's a number there in that table. And I can't get my code to go move across the screen horizontally, or the scroll bar on there. This is what's getting me trouble. There we go. Right. Oops. Why is Jen disappearing? Jen. Okay, so this object is this object is that you see here is basically just taking the angle that I'm putting into the system by dragging on the scroll box and then running it through the equation, assuming that the distance away that my string is able to reach is going to be a very low number. And then it's calculating the xy position of that and updating the xy position of the camera as well as this little object. So if we do that, if we do this every time the metronome hits, then we get the illusion of a moving object. So we just calculate, once we've moved, we calculate the equation again as if this point is 0, as if the angle is the same, which gives our next object to move to. So that was the simplest way I could think of making an object. Okay, so how you would do Minecraft with this, just to expand on what you would do with the code. If I know the apartment number of the location where my player is, if the system knows that, which I can do by looking up the table, I gotta translate my x and y back into apartment numbers. I could have just gone with two tables, I don't know. Anyways, I can read what's there, which in this case, I've written a little bit of code to decide what should happen if the number is not 1. If the number is not 1, then the little spaceship is free to keep moving. If I read on the table that the number is 2, so there's a table reader there. I'm reading that table. What it does is it activates a gate which prevents my metronome object from continuing to do this loop of updating the coordinates based on the polar information. And so then it's just a matter of, if I wanted to create a game like Tron, then I'm keeping a record of which square we were in last, and then after you've left the square, writing in the number that's going to signify that there's a wall there. And then you would, as you're moving along, you'd be creating a wall behind your character. If I wanted to pick up an object that's in a square and move it somewhere else, that would be a little bit more complex. What I would have to do is, say if I wanted to pick up this square, well, this number is 4, I go up to the edge of it, and I would need to be able to read that area of the table, find out if it's 4 or not. If it is 4, then I'm going to store that someplace, and then I'm going to write 1 here. So it looked like that object disappeared and now it's in my inventory. And then I would move somewhere else, say here, and then I would write 4 into the table there. And instantly Gem would reflect that change in the transformation on the cube output. So that's kind of, I mean, there's lots of little details that go into this. Once again, I don't recommend that you necessarily try to create a full-fledged video game in PE, but it's a little bit different idiom for translating the concepts. It is possible to do actually some game-like idioms like Tron writing, or I guess the computer version is called Novatron, writing blocks behind you. One of the things that's really interesting for me to do with this is getting back to the first part of my presentation, the idea of having musical blocks. With this, basically we have a world that we can move around blocks from place to place. The commercial game Minecraft has music blocks. They play a single ascending scale, I believe, so da-da-da-da-da. And that's what you get from it. If you were to put them in rows, and then like in the beginning of my presentation, next steps that I'm doing in this programming is just basically putting a texture file for the number 4 that would look like this. With number 4 would assign the texture of this one, different ones like that. So as players move around the level, they can make rows like this and then perform it by hopping from one piece to the next instead of flying across it like a spaceship. And so, yeah, that's the kind of what I've been working on over the summer. And a further application that I think would be really interesting to do with this would be using positional sound based on these objects. Instead of having an environment that's transmitted to you by a gem, you could have spatialized sound, still moving about in the same way, but then having that represented to you by sound in a way that can be accessed by blind users, which I think would be a really fascinating market to open up with some of the human interface devices that are available now. In the meantime, I'm making a computer game.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Why is it important to you that, or is it important to you that this is like a three-dimensional spatial world that is moved within like Minecraft, whereas I sort of expected you to create the die in PD and then like they can be shuffled or they can be positioned and then it would play, or do you know what I mean? Like the interface could just be the dice that get lined up and then play or something. So why this whole three-dimensional space?
Right. That's a good question, actually. It's possible. It's possible to create a sequencer in PE using a very small number of objects. It's possible to have a video overlay, have it shoot information that you like. Guitar Hero and do a clone of Guitar Hero in PD. It's annoying. I did it first. It took quite a while to get a video to sync to audio, which you'd think would be one of the things that an environment like PD would do out of the box. It doesn't. I guess the answer to that is that it's been done. I wasn't sure if it would be engaging enough for an audience to want to do that, depending on the context. Okay, so if you could project what you just described, if you could project it on a wall in a public place and have people change it by putting their hands on the wall, I'm sure that that would get used. If you're doing a desktop a PC for your place that you want to deliver it, kids already have the choice of thousands of games they can play online, so why would they want to play a really challenging music game? If they do, they're probably going to want to play Fantasia, which is made by Disney, which is using gestures, which is really exciting, but nonetheless not not challenging you at the level that where over time you'd be developing skills like an orchestral percussionist. There's no reason why you couldn't have those types of challenges in games. They're similarly cognitively difficult challenges that they just don't happen to be that precise in terms of rhythm, unless you're playing Street Fighter and you need to initiate a fireball move or something like that, then the rhythm does turn out to be important. The other aspect of this is that by loading in a table like this, the size of my world can be whatever I want it to be, right? A JPEG file is 37 kilobytes, maybe for a small one in a web browser. The table file for all of these objects is smaller than that. One of the strengths now that I've gotten to this point is that I could have 100 different players create a little world of different rhythms that I've created and share it with someone else. So it kind of extends what you can do with, I think that all of those things should be done. Like, I think people should be thinking about the LRT space that's being designed now. Are there any art-based interactive things that people can do there? That might be a solution for why, like at an event like this, we've got this is a pretty good turnout for an event like this. It'd be great to have the outreach go a little further. There's different ways you can do that. I think one of them would be like a public art interactive, where people can come and change things in it. Another one would be a free game that people could download and maybe Scratch from MIT is done pretty well with this. People are doing little game prototypes and then they upload them and other people can mess around with the game prototypes. This is what I'm doing.
So, any other questions? We can hang around and chat more too. So thank you, Samuel. Yeah.
So that one table, the table viz, is that the world? The terrain viz?
Yeah, I'll show you what the table actually is. Whoops. Saved in a text file that PD writes. And it's just got 1001. Oh, this isn't the right one. Okay. anyways, it's a very minimal data structure. Basically, it's a number, and then a space, a new line character, and then another number, a new line character. So that can be read into PD really fast.
And so you just keep an idea of like a width of the world?
Yeah. So the width of the table that's being read, I actually decided that 40 by 40 wasn't big enough. I can go over how that looks. The code in this environment tends to get a little bit cluttered. This is the cleaned up version of how this works. Okay. So what this little command here does is it tells the table terrain underscore viz to set the value to whatever I put in this box. So now I'm changing everything in the table to different numbers.
It looks like it's zooming.
So this is another point of what it's all relative. If I wanted to use that as a technique to move the camera, then I could change what's being added to the numbers. Instead of moving the camera, I can move my world up and down. It's all relative. If I read the text file again, then it's now, as it's rendering the frames, it's reading that text file instead.
I see like certain squares are sort of lifted from the like there's this different dimension, like you have from that. Is that a certain parameter or?
So that's just whether, so think about the apartment building analogy again. That's whether there's someone in the apartment building.
Okay, so that would be, for example, that would be, there would be like a music, maybe a, like a musical cell in one of those, the one that would be sort of...
Yeah.
Okay, I see.
Okay, so with this object, it's a shame that I took this apart, but now I can show you putting it together again. So this object is selecting for whether we get 1, 2, or 3. Whoops, scale is probably not a good place to send that. And it's sending an RGB value to color based on that. Cool. Yeah. Sorry, it's still... Okay. Okay, so now when it's reading a 1, before it calculates the frame, now it not only says, let's move this up to Z value, whatever, let's make it the right color. Now I can actually show a little better the one little bit of interactivity that this makes us almost game-like, sort of a simulation, is that when I drive over the teal-colored bricks, I'm writing into that table and turning it into 1. It makes it look like that brick is disappearing when I'm chomping it up like Pac-Man. It's for people who have done a little bit of programming before, this is probably not too mind-blowing how much usability you can get out of a table object or a database.
So each of those, you could affect the parameters of each of those cubes there too, is that right? So you change the color, but you could also change the sound. You could output audio data based on...
Yeah, precisely. I didn't hook up the audio for this, but so there's... basically what's happening in this code in the top of the screen here is it's receiving the player's position from somewhere else in the code and saying, let's see what's in the table at our position here. Okay? And it's sending that number into this gate. So this gate is a numbered gate. It'll send, it will open whichever number we send it. So if the area is, if the number is 1 or 2, then it's letting the data go through this thing that's calculating my movement. If the number is 3 or 4 or something else like that, then it's closing off the gate. And it's doing that by reading the table. So when we have a collision that's happening in the game, basically it's the player position saying, hey, is it okay to move to this position, this next position on the map? Is it okay? And this other bit of code says, well, let's wait, let's check the table first to see if this is a legal spot on our game map, a legal spot for you to move. Okay, so the number in that area of the table is 4, so we can't move there. So stop the movement code, similar to what you would have happening in Dungeons and Dragons game. We ask the dungeon master what you see ahead of you, and it turns out to be something you can't cross through. That encoding of the world that's there has to be done by some process. It could be done by the dungeon master saying, okay, you can't move. It could be done by this saying, hey, we can't add a number to your movement incrementer anymore because we shut that off because the cube that you're next to is an illegal move. Thanks for coming.
Have you made a musical?
I have. The great thing about PD is you could send your messages anywhere. Right? I could, every time I cross the square, I could send a message to a 3D printer somewhere to print me a cube. In this case, I actually set up a different system, which ended up being a little bit less fun. Where every time we'd have a beat coming down, it might be like 60 beats per minute or 1 second. Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah, that's more like 9 minutes. See, this is, yeah.
Sorry.
And then this same map, actually, I have to stand up on the chair.
Use the pointer
stick. So you'd
have
your player. Oh yeah, the pointer stick.
That's what it's there for.
Use the property.
I have a video of this being done, but this computer's network card is broken. So we'd have the player position here, and it would send. So this is just nothing. So we would just go tap, tap, and this would represent a different rhythm. And this would also represent a different rhythm because it's a different color. So I'm going to make this long, long. Short, short, shorty, shorty, longer. Okay. Okay, so then.
Same? So I guess it, in a way it's kind of like, I mean, I don't want to sound like I'm simplifying, but it's like a two-dimensional sequencer.
Yeah.
Which I think is really cool.
Yeah, to start off with. I mean,
infinite, it could be
that. No, it's good. It's good to simplify, right? Like, I said Minecraft basically for the sake of a reason to have a third dimension in this. The reason why I didn't want to get into that right away was that with a 40 by 40 area. Oops. So yeah, you could have this sort of perspective and then have to deal with what's above you. You could have cubes above and below. This is the same question anytime you're making a PD patch. If you've got multiple dimensions in your control device, what do you want to use those dimensions for? Mm-hmm. So you have the exact same thing of like, okay.
The mapping process, right, in terms of associating.
So did you end up using much up and down for this?
Well, that's what I was saying in terms of like, how do you define, how do you associate the aesthetics in relationship to the movement? I mean, one of the most obvious ones is like, okay, the pitch will be this way,
right,
the roll will be this way, the same as a keyboard, you know, there's an immediate association with, you know, time, X, Y, time versus position. I don't know. Like, my point is like, that can be an aesthetic decision as well,
right,
as a maybe a more pedagogical one in terms, I guess, more traditional music.
Who here has ever seen sequencers that they use to create electronic music? Basically, you've got a graph.
Those button things?
Like a button thing with permit based sequencer.
So we could...
a button thing. That's the thing we're looking for.
Okay, hold on. So we could read this row as C and this row as C sharp. Or we could read this, we could read all of these orange ones as C and all of these green ones as C sharp if we wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And then have this be like Mario Paint that you could read in two directions, right? So obviously you would get C, 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 C sharp, but if you're moving this way, you get C sharp, C sharp, C sharp, C. The problem would be like, how do you translate that into meaningful gameplay for people? And I think there are ways to do it. One thing that's unfortunate with the Guitar Hero paradigm is that they've gone with something that works and they've milked it with not really branching out into a lot of new territory.
Did you see that 2048 with notes?
Where, I think, like, I heard about that somewhere.
Where you'd go with like B sharp versus C flat, right? So you try to match up the same notes.
Oh, cool.
The things that should be the same note, like, because you got multiple representations.
Oh, really?
And yeah, so if you match them up, then they combine up, and they keep combining up, and it's sort of like that 2048 game,
right,
that grid one.
How
but it's with notes?
Have you seen it? Like, how much time? I mean, this is a problem in game design if you're going to have some kind of...
Well, I don't know.
How much time do you spend doing musical stuff, and how much time do you spend doing block shifting stuff? No, that block shifting isn't musical.
Well, to be honest, I didn't know a lot before that, so I had to figure out how to like count keys and things like that.
Awesome.
So it's
That's great, right?
Yeah.
I think though that like, the demographic that you're in, you're someone who has a college degree,
yeah,
and you're someone who wants casual games to play on your spare time, right? It would be great if there are a way with games to target that for a little bit younger audience,
mm-hmm,
and especially an audience that they don't have parents that are saying, okay, you've got 5 minutes of free time, I want you to play Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego, right?
But in something like this, you could say, you could give them a note, and you can say, find similar notes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just using the same game idea that the game I just told you.
Right.
So you could go, find notes that are the same. And, you know, there's these, like, B-sharps hanging around.
Yeah.
You gave
them... Yeah, and then what you did is similar to what one of my cousins did, which is, he was really interested in this game from Final Fantasy or whatever. And he went online, and he was like, there's sheet music for this game for piano online. I'm going to figure it out. So he was inspired by his experience in the game, and then he went and said, okay, what do I have to do to turn this into another type of performance for my piano? And he did the exact same thing of, oh, okay, so this is the staff notation. How does that translate into my piano? What steps do I need to take, right? That type of learner is the type of learner we want everyone to be, where they're independently figuring out, okay, I'm obsessed with this now, I've got to figure out the skills that I need in order to realize my expression in some sort of performance. So one of the things that games are maybe good at is hiding the fact that it's something that I'm a little intimidated to do at first, because it's in a game environment that conceals it. One of the things that games do badly so far, if they're over the internet, is that it's a very competitive environment. So if you entertain people more than challenge them, I mean, this is something that game designers have complained about, is that where have all the challenging games gone, right? People have these great theatrical set pieces that, you know, you press the green button on your controller, that's all you do, and your God of War character goes and just flies around and smashes all these things, right? And the feedback is that you get from the system is really disproportionate to the performance that you did on your controller. I think with the Oculus Rift and some of the interface devices, it's kind of renewed some interest in, and Guitar Hero being one of the, and Dance Dance Revolution being one of the sort of precursors of this, of getting back into, hey, I'm doing something in the room with my body that everyone can see. Everyone can see it takes a lot of skill, and I'm doing this, and this is kind of cool, right? You can approach that setting as if it were a joke, which is really great, because if you have a kid that doesn't give a shit, the chances of them wanting to picture themselves as getting up on a stage and conducting an orchestra, that's really low, right? The chances of them saying, okay, my friends are playing Rock Band and they need a drummer for the drum part, okay, I think I can fit into this social scene. The chances of that are just a lot better. So, but it's, I think that a lot of people in the makers movement have bits and pieces of the skills that are really close, both at an interaction level and an interface level, to fitting in a need that would be interesting for a lot of different people. So it's one of the things that, like, ideologically I push for. This is like, this is an output.